But the real hope here is that you don't have to listen to me talk for 3 hours every Monday night, that I actually get folks in to do much of the talking for me, people who are smarter and more entertaining than I am. And though the first part of the course is focused on analysis and understanding of how games work, an opportunity presented itself today that I thought was too good to pass up. And so we do, in fact, have a guest who may actually talk a little bit about game analysis, but that would be pretty interesting and unexpected for me.
Me too.
So let me stop beating around the bush and introduce, this is Patricia York. She's the Director of Human Resources for Disney Interactive Studios. And so she's been helping, you know, me and my studio become integrated into the Disney family. And since she was here, it actually didn't take any arm twisting at all to get her in front of you guys. So basically, we're going to talk about a topic near and dear to all of your hearts, as I understand it, after last week, which is, how do you get a job in the game business? I gave you kind of my take on it, which was get a job in QA. Or become the best at what you do in a specialty. Now we'll find out what someone who actually does this every day for a living has to say about that. So let's welcome Pat York.
Thank you.
So well, let's start with what your title means and what exactly you do.
What my title means? Well, I'm in charge of human resources for all of Disney Interactive's internal development studios. We have different kinds of development. We have relationships with third-party developers, which I don't have anything to do with, but I'm responsible for all of our internal ones. So we have 5 studios around the world right now, the newest of which is, of course, Warren's studio. So my job is just to take care of them all and make sure they're all staffed, that they have growth and development plans, that that we have the right people in leadership roles, we're growing people, and making the best games possible.
And how did you get involved with games and human resources and Disney in particular?
Kind of an interesting story. I was working in forestry, and so I thought, I have a very long HR career. You're trying to figure out, okay, natural resources to video games. How did that possibly happen? But I'm from Vancouver, Canada. That's where I live, and my job is traveling around. So you're probably wondering why I end up in Austin, but I do a lot of traveling for my job. But in Vancouver, I worked in human resources for a long time, and a good friend of mine was telling me about this new business that was happening up in Vancouver and getting into the video games up there, and she thought, it's young, it's vibrant, it seems like it might really suit you, you might really like it. And I thought, oh, well, whatever, I don't know what they do. But she had an invitation to go to dinner with one of the executives there and said, I'm going to dinner, give me your resume. I'm not even looking for a job, but I gave her my resume, and next thing you know, I got a phone call, and the rest was history. I headed off really well, met some executive producers there. Here's a clue how you know a job interview is going really well: when they give you presents. So right at the end of the interview, the executive producer, and you may know him, he's been an executive producer most of Electronic Arts sports games. That's where I went to work. And he reached behind him and said, I got a present for you, and he handed me a whole bunch of games. So I went home that night and told my son that I had been interviewing with this company, Electronic Arts. Did he know of them? And he went, EA? You're interviewing with EA? And I go, I guess. And sure enough, little did I know that on our shelf in our family room are all of EA's games, which we've had for years and years and years. So that was how I got into the games industry.
And how did you get from EA to Disney?
To Disney, yeah. I was at EA for 5 years, grew them from EA Canada from 500 to 1,800 employees. Yeah, it was a pretty aggressive growth over the 5-year period. And from that, I went out and started my own little HR consulting company. And have you guys ever heard of Propaganda Games, who are making Turok? Making the new Turok game? Yeah, well, I know those guys really, really well. And when they left EA to start on their own, they gave me a phone call and said, we're doing our own thing. Do you want to come help us staff it up? And I went, sure, sounds like fun to me. And they were quickly bought by Disney about 3 months later, and the rest is history. And Disney picked up me and put me in charge of all the studios, because that's what I do. So, yeah, it's been a very interesting ride.
So Disney has five studios. We now know that one of them is propaganda and one of them is Junction Point Studios. How is Disney structured?
Yeah, Disney has, well, the five studios, the one thing that Disney does in acquiring studios or doing startups is we want to make sure that all these studios maintain their own culture and they have their own expertise in the games that they make. So Propaganda Games of Vancouver is doing Turok. They have another project that has not yet been announced, so I won't talk about that, but it's going to be fabulous, and it's going to be a few years until it comes out. And Turok will be shipping in February. And Avalanche Software in Salt Lake City, they make the games that are associated with Disney's feature animated films. So there was a Chicken Little movie, there's a Chicken Little game, that kind of thing. Then there's Fall Line Studios in Salt Lake City as well. And they are the studio that we like to call our Nintendo Center of Excellence. They make the games for the Wii and for the DS. So they're making, and again, it's all the Disney kind of Disney licensed games. And then there's Black Rock Studios in the UK, and that is, we bought the racing division of Climax Group. So Climax Racing, and they made the ATV games, MotoGP, that kind of thing. So we bought that, and this renamed them now Black Rock Studios, and they're focusing on racing titles. And then, of course, there's Warren's Group.
So that sounds like a lot of growth really quickly. How many people does Disney Interactive have, and what are the growth plans for the future? I mean, are these folks going to have lots of job openings they can apply for?
Oh, yes. I want to see your resumes when you're ready, for sure. Yeah, when I joined Disney Interactive, there was about 150 people. Now there's over 800, and I've only been doing this for almost 2 years. So that's a significant growth. The growth plans this year, right now, across all studios that I have about 150 openings. So there's certainly going to be more. And the growth plans are quite significant with looking at ways to grow, whether it's a startup, whether it's an acquisition, if it's the right one for the company, and of course growing the studios that we have right now. So there's a lot of there's more positions. I think most game companies are finding this. There's more positions than there are people. So it's more important that we're out looking all the time.
So what kinds of things are you looking for? I mean, is it mostly programmers, mostly artists, mostly designers? What are the toughest things to fill for an HR guy?
I mean, we're always looking for everything. I mean, there's lots of programming jobs, of course, and lots of art jobs. One of the jobs that's getting to be really difficult to find are level designers. That one's become quite hard. And I think level designers are now starting to realize their worth, and so it's becoming even harder to attract them to different locations. But as the games get more complex, it has become a career path of its own. So that's quite difficult. Good concept art is not always easy to find as well, because lots of people can put together something after you've told them what you want, but to actually dream it up themselves, that is not always an easy thing to do. Another thing I'm looking for is good producers, people who can really lead the teams, you know, and move into that whole producer, executive producer career path.
What do you look for in job candidates? I mean, does it vary from position to position, or are there certain common things that you look for in folks that you want to hire?
The most common, passion. Really love what you're doing. I mean, passion. Passion for games. Otherwise, it's not just another job. Working in this industry is not on the assembly line making widgets. You do spend a lot of time and a lot of hours in it, and you got to love it. You just have to love it. So you have to play it. If you don't play games, you won't be really great in the industry. So that's the main thing. I always ask people, what games do you play and why? What is your favorite? What is the game that you would like to play? What is it that you get so absorbed in that you lose all track of time, and why? So passion for the industry is really important, because you will work really hard.
So you didn't mention industry experience. I mean, if you're trying to get a shot in Hollywood. You know, there's that catch 22. You've got to be in a guild before you can, or in a union before you can actually do the job. Industry experience, is that important in the game business?
It is important at certain levels, not to get into the business. You know, and that also is really depends on the job that we're recruiting for. Right now, I'm looking for programmers. I'll look within the aerospace industry for really great programmers, you know. So there's always, and it's not as always when I'm presenting these candidates, like, oh, they don't have any game experience. I know, but take a look at them, you know. So, and often they'll get a job. We need to really, because there's such a shortage of people out there, you need to really be branching out and find people in different areas. Game industry experience is only important if I'm going to be hiring somebody in a senior role. They can't do it without the industry experience. They just can't. But they need to be able to get in there. I'll hire people right out of school with no experience whatsoever, and then we'll train them and grow them throughout the industry.
Yeah. So is there anything people without industry experience, say, can do to make their resumes jump out? I mean, what is it that attracts your eye? Is it a degree? Is it a university on the resume? Mm-hmm. Is it a particular kind of job? What can people do to actually attract your eye?
Yeah, well, if you're in a program like this, I want to know what you did. I want to know about your project that you worked on, what it looked like. I would like to see samples of it. I want to know exactly what part that you played in that. I don't want to hear the sort of generalities of we did this, we worked on that. I want to know what was your role, what you did, what piece did you own in creating whatever it was that you did in your project. That's really important. And again, I will ask you specifically that. I'll also ask you specifically what games you're playing in your free time.
So. Okay. And how important is games education? Or how important do you think it could become? Is this something that Disney is keeping an eye on, that you're keeping an eye on?
Absolutely. You know, it used to be that you could get into the industry just because, you know, you played, you know, 70 hours of games a week in your parents' basement or whatever. And, you know, you were totally dedicated, and that's what you did. You just played games. Therefore, you were good at games, and therefore you could work in the industry. And it didn't really matter. But it really matters now, and you'll see a lot of, because the technology is always changing, it's getting more complex. Making a game for, you know, next gen, making it on a PlayStation 3 or on the Xbox 360 is much more complex than it was back in the early days when they were making it on, name something, anything, yeah, absolutely anything, on a Sega system or something.
Okay, the C64 was challenging, right?
The 64, yeah. But, you know, it's so much more complex now that these game courses and programs have become increasingly more important. The other side of it is that you're getting good business skills in them as well, which is really important going forward, that you know, not just how to make a game, but you understand the business of games as well. So you know what appeals to the consumer, you know what to make, what makes really engaging, fun gameplay. And you learn that.
Well, on that topic, it'd be nice to talk about what sorts of games Disney makes.
Yeah,
and
sure.
I know you've got some video. Do you want to?
I do. Yeah.
Show that.
Should we hit one up?
Sure.
Right, this is just a little sample.
Here's where we mess around with the camera.
Sure, we kind of pull the strings along and try not to look too silly doing it. Okay.
Go full screen on that.
If I can see it.
For 1300 years, the water
did I get it? No.
Has been closed. And the land has fallen into darkness.
Can you see that?
And a new hero must rise to take back Narnia.
Okay, so now we know that Disney does movie licensed titles and sequels to earlier games. Okay.
Right.
So that's one thing. Let's look at another.
If it'll come up.
Uh-oh. Okay.
He's going to drive.
I'm going to drive. This is not my computer. This could be a disaster.
It's my computer. It could be a disaster.
Okay. Oh, let's do this one first. What
okay.
the heck?
This is fun. This one, I just get a kick out of it.
Okay. I know a lot of you are now sitting here thinking, what the heck?
Is the volume up on this?
But this game looks really cool.
Product not yet rated.
I knew you were going to laugh.
Come on, let's go.
play it.
I know you're all in the target demographic for that one, but I gotta say, okay, listen, I know I work for the Disney Corporation now, you don't have to believe a word I'm saying, but I'm telling you, the freeform jamming gameplay in that thing is really cool. I mean, when you can get together with four of your friends and be playing freeform and recording the stuff and making your own songs and, you know, sending them to your friends, I'm buying many copies, okay? I'm sorry, I admit it.
Our general manager says that this is the true test of those of you who are really secure in your masculinity.
I am secure. Oh my God, it's going to be so humiliating. Okay, so we know they do TV licensed stuff. Oh, I didn't want to do that, sorry.
Which one do you want to do?
I want to do that.
He's speaking Japanese, so... don't necessarily need to hear it.
So that's a sequel to an original title, right?
Yeah, that's original IP. Disney has sort of a model of we do 80% of the Disney licensed things, 20% of things that are associated with films and TV and TV shows, and then 10% of original IP. So this falls in that category.
And the first one was one of the best-selling games on the Nintendo DS. One of the things that most people don't know is, I mean, Disney is one of the top two or three Nintendo DS handheld publishers in the industry, which is kind of cool. Okay, so then we'll sort of hit this one next.
This is when we need the sound on.
It was supposed to be a simple mission. In and out in 3 days. But then things went wrong. Terribly wrong.
That's not your little sister's Disney.
Notice it doesn't say Disney. It's Touchstone.
Okay, we can wrap up the audio-visual portion of this with one last one.
This is just a preview of everything that Disney does, because it's pretty big what encompasses the Disney world.
I will return to hard-hitting objective journalist mode in just a second, but can I say how cool it is that they have a studio here in town? Okay, end of that.
That's his plug.
That's a heartfelt opinion. Wait, I lost my chair. Okay. All right, so that's kind of what Disney does. It's maybe a little more varied than people would expect. Okay, so back to hard-hitting journalist without pen. Oh well. Where do you find most of your candidates? You know, you've obviously got a lot of people you need to hire. Are they coming from Monster.com? Are they coming from universities? Where are you finding them?
They're not coming from Monster.com. That is not where we look for them at all. So if we're going to look for them, we do a lot of university recruiting for sure. We're always out there looking for the best and the brightest students. One of our strategies is that we like to get to know the different professors in schools and whatnot so we can know who are the best students and the ones that we should be talking to about jobs. Another one, too, there's lots of other places, too. I'm sure you all know about Gamma Sutra. If you go into GammaSutra.com, we're always looking. We post there as well. Postings aren't always the best way for us to find candidates, but they do find us some. We use things like creative heads and all those sort of, you know, game things. We do a lot of networking as well to make sure it's always like who you know. One of the biggest sources of employees for us is referrals. So it's getting to know somebody. We probably, last year in the game companies, we probably filled about 60% of our openings through referrals. And I'd like to see that number even go higher. So, you know, if you're hired in, so if you were hired to Disney, one of the first things I would be doing is sitting down to and ask you, who do you know? Who do you think would be good here? Who would you like to recommend to come and work for us as well? So one of the strategies for you is to get to know people who work in the game company so you can be one of those people that is referred in. There's your ticket. So I'm sure that Warren will be keeping close eyes on all of you. But that is one of the things that we do. The other thing we do is absolutely reaching out for people. We will gather the credits off of game boxes. We will phone people who did some spectacular games in a genre that we're particularly looking for, and we'll cold call. We'll start calling.
Wow. That's a rough thing to do.
We have a crew of recruiters and things who do that.
Does Disney use interns? I know several people asked about that.
Yeah, absolutely we do. We use interns at all our locations. We do have a well-established intern program in Glendale, California. I'll tell you a little bit about that because there's things that we want to be able to do with Warren as we go on growing his studio as well. But the internship there is called a think tank. And the students are coming in and we actually get them in a room together and to think up new IP for us. And so think of new games. And Spectropes actually came out of one of those discussions at some point and came out of there. So we were looking, that's one of the things that we do. And they're paid internships too. So that's kind of a nice thing to know that you actually get paid on these ones. We want the best students. And so we do take in two intakes there at Glendale for a 6-month term at a time. The other studios do it as well. A studio in Avalanche had, and Salt Lake City had 14 interns this summer. And their plans are growing more. So each studio does have its own little intern program. So lots of opportunities if you're willing to move and go somewhere else if there's not enough here. So.
Well, tell me what is it like working for Disney?
Oh, it's fun.
Yeah, it's a magic.
It's really, it really sounds hokey, but it really is. It's a fun thing. It just puts a smile on my face. It really does. I have so much fun doing it because it's a really big company, and Disney Interactive Studios is a very small part of a huge company, but it's so creative and people are, they're all. Exciting, you know, they're really fun to work with, and it's that passion, that creation that I really like. It's, as I talked about that earlier, what am I looking for in people? It's that passion for what you do, and Disney does do that, and they lots of ways for you to grow yourself as well, and lots of opportunities. So, it's exciting. It's hard work, and it's exhausting sometimes, but it is really really fun.
One of the things that, you know, I'm the new kid on the block, so what do I know really? But one of the things that strikes me every time I visit. Glendale or any of the Burbank locations or any place else in the Disney organization, it feels like there really is there's a creative core culture. Mm-hmm. And when I think about how big the company is, it's 120,000 employees.
Something like that, yeah.
That's huge. That's the entire game business, I think. Mm-hmm. And yet there is this amazing culture and everybody sort of buys into the mission. And I've never actually seen that happen at any game studio or any game publisher. Mm-hmm. Are there things in place at Disney that make that happen, or what? How does that work?
Yeah, it's part of the magic, I think. You know, it's everybody there in a Disney company. We're not employees, you're cast members. So you feel like you're part of something big. You know, you're part of the cast of this, the big Disney company. In game companies, we don't necessarily call them that, but certainly within the Disney it is. You know, so that's a little bit of the magic in there. But creativity is really encouraged. There are things like within Disney Interactive Studios, we have a creativity council. We have an art council. We have a technology council. We're just starting a production council. And these are to share learnings and to share ideas and technologies across all the different locations. So it's a part of, not only do you have your regular job of creating the games, but we want to find better and smarter and faster ways of doing it. We're not looking for a cookie-cutter approach. We don't want to say that you have to use, you know, one engine, you know, say the Unreal Engine or something at every single studio, because that wouldn't make sense. But we do want to find out ways that we can share technologies and to share creativity. So.
And one of the other things that struck me as very different is there's so much more talking across studios mm-hmm. within Disney Interactive than I'm mm-hmm. used to at other publishing houses and developers.
Yeah.
And even beyond that, In the time I've been with Disney as a contractor for a while doing concept development, and now as an employee, as a cast member, it takes a little while to get used to it, you know. But, you know, I've already had the opportunity to meet with some of the Imagineering yeah. folks and some of the Disney R&D
yes.
folks, who are way smart, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
And some of the, I've had conversations with people from Pixar now, mm-hmm. and I know Avalanche has a lot of discussions with feature animation, and I've been
yes.
over there. That's another thing, that kind of exchange of ideas. I certainly hope that's a part of the culture, and I hope it continues, because it's one of the most exciting things for me.
It's incredibly exciting. I was at in San Francisco last week, and we did a tour through Pixar, because now they're part of the Disney family as well. And it's, you're walking into a place like that, it's so exciting. The creativity is like almost oozing out of their walls just about it. It's so exciting. So there's, now that they are part of the Disney group, there is opportunities for us to be able to do some sharing in that. There's Pixar University, so we want to figure out ways that we can get our people into Pixar University, because they offer lots of courses and things that make sense for our industry as well. Because we are really very more closely aligned to film than we are to, you know, other parts of Disney. So there are opportunities in there to be able to share things. You talk about Avalanche and feature animation. They are developing a very close relationship. Before they were making the games, before they were Disney, they were making some of the games that came out of the films, but they didn't necessarily have as close of a relationship because they weren't of the same group. Now they visit each other, and so they're able to share ideas. They get to know what's happening in the film before it's even publicized. So that really helps them to make a better game. So there's going to be more and more as we grow, we're getting to know the people in the other divisions, and we're looking for ways that we can share information.
You know, I'll tell you a story that's pretty funny. I was at a function with a bunch of Pixar folks, and I was, you know, one of the things that I want to do involves really robust fluid simulations. I need a really cool real-time fluid simulation model, and I'm not going to say any more than that. But I was talking to a Pixar engineer, and just ask him if, you know, he could help me out. I mean, because I know they do water better than anybody else in the world, so I figure they must know something. And he said, well, I'm not really the guy you want to talk to, but I can hook you up with someone who really does fluid simulations well. And he walked away after a little more conversation. And another guy from Pixar was standing there, and when this first guy walked away, he just said, that guy is one of the top two or three fluid simulation guys on the planet. And it's like, that's the quality of people that we're working with.
Yeah.
It's pretty amazing.
Yeah,
so okay, I said I wasn't going to go into you know, public relations mode. Sorry. Is there anything I should have asked you that I didn't before we open this up to the crowd?
I think one question that I do like to ask candidates, and I usually have somebody who's more technical than not with me when I'm asking a question like this, is what game do you play? And if you could meet the person who made that game, what would you tell them about it, and what would you do differently?
Ooh, I got to write that one down.
So it's just something to think about, because we want to see, just get to drive into your creativity a little bit.
And you're going to get plenty of practice answering that question, asking and answering that question during the semester, so that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
So do you guys have any questions for Pat?
What's the percentage of entry-level positions? I mean, say you hire a wide range of people, but most of those are, of course, out of our reach. So what's the percentage of entry-level and junior positions that you tend to hire?
Mm-hmm. So the question is, what's the percentage of entry-level positions that you hire?
Yeah, it depends on the studio that we're hiring for, because usually in the early stages of a studio, they have a lot more senior people than they do junior people. And as they start to staff up and grow and get maybe more than one project, then they start bringing in more junior people. That's happening at the other studios right now a lot, that my mandate this year is to bring in a whole lot more junior people because I want to balance that off a little better. So we have quite a few seniors right now, so I want more juniors.
I can tell you from at Junction Point, we're in the position where we really are trying to bring on our most senior people, mm-hmm. and that's our critical need. But even at Junction Point in the next year, we have a substantial number we've identified this is going to be an entry-level position. This is a junior position. Mm-hmm. There are a bunch of them. So we'll have openings for you guys. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? In the back there?
I was wondering, you mentioned you were looking for producers. How do producers in the game industry sort of differ from, any other sort of medium?
Maybe as producers in the film industry?
Yeah, how are producers in the game business different from producers in other media?
Yeah, that's a very good question, because each studio even has sort of a different definition of producers, and one of my tasks is trying to get them all calling the same things, that so we all know that when we're talking about producer, we're all talking about the same job.
Remember, but yeah. Let me interrupt you for one second. Yeah. Remember last week when I said we don't even have a vocabulary for discussing what we do for a living?
Mm-hmm.
We now have corroboration from the outside.
I'm working on it. It's one of my biggest tasks that I've been working on for the last year, is just to get that common job titles and things across studios so that we all are talking about the same things. So producer can mean different things. One thing it can mean is a project manager. It's taking care of the finance and the end and the scheduling of the game. Others can be more creative, that it really focuses on the creative direction of the game. And every once in a while, you get somebody who's good at both. But, it depends. So whenever you see a producer posting there, read it carefully, because it could mean almost anything.
Yeah, I'll tell you, at Junction Point, and at Ion Storm before that, pretty much at Origin, producer was the person in charge of. I used to describe it as the person in charge of the studio's interests or the business's interests. Whereas we had project director or lead designer who was responsible for just making the best game. Okay, and the tension between those two positions is where greatness happens in my mm-hmm. mind. It's not in any one of those having the bulk of the weight or the bulk of the authority. And at Junction Point, it's very much a budgeting, scheduling, team management job. Obviously, everybody contributes. Everybody's a designer, is one of the other sort of truisms at my studio. But the producer role really is very much an administrative and management thing. And what I always tell people who are ask me what do I do for a living? Back when I was a producer, I was lucky enough to be at Origin when we had this sort of mixture of creative and management. So I was very lucky to get in there. But I told people to read A Pound of Flesh by Art Linson. Art Linson is a well-known Hollywood producer. He's made some terrific movies. I won't go into it. Read A Pound of Flesh, and you'll kind of know what producers live through if they're lucky. The living part.
Mm-hmm.
Any other questions? Yeah.
So I'm kind of curious about production, but I mean, I actually worked on something for Disney over the summer, but I have no idea what a junior level producer does, because it's so high level in most cases what a producer's job is. But how does someone start low man on totem pole in production?
Well, Warren wasn't far off the mark when he said starting QA. I really do. A lot of the best producers have come out of QA. And some of the ones that I know now that are leading studios started in QA. So that's, that's one way to really move up the ranks into the production one. Because then you're testing the game, you know the game, and you know what works in there. Now, some of the things the junior producers do, it'll depend, on the genre. For instance, in a sports title, one of the very junior producer roles will be, updating all the stats and things for the next version. It would be, keeping the databases up to date and things like that. In some of the other studios, it will be just making sure that all the, keeping track of all the features, that everything is there. It's a lot of database work and tracking work. So then working with the different groups to bring together all the pieces so that everybody knows what they're supposed to do next. So it's more like a project scheduler kind of job. Yeah.
Yeah. Again, just to jump in, an assistant producer position is one that doesn't require any expertise. It requires, you know, organizational skills, mm-hmm. communication skills, facility with, you know, mm-hmm. some project management tools. It's a project management thing, mm-hmm. More than anything else. So it really is. If you're interested in becoming a producer, it's not the job that requires a ton of experience, I guess. Mm-hmm. And we'll talk more about roles as the semester goes on. So we'll come back to what producers do and how you become one later on. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Both of y'all said that in order to get a job, you start in QA. But I know a lot of companies, when you work in QA, like you work there for like a year, they'll let you go. Like if you haven't moved anywhere, you know, beyond QA. But what can you do to make yourself, you know, be distinctive, be a proper candidate for, you know, designer or producer?
Yeah, you do have a crowd to stand out in, for sure. One of the things I would look for is doing a QA, not in a big QA department, but at the studio location itself. Because a lot of companies have QA done centrally, and they have these big QA places where, you know, you bring in contractors and they work for a certain period of time, and you let them go and you bring another wave, etc. That isn't necessarily the best way. The best way is actually having some QA positions sitting in the studios working alongside the game, because then you're part of that team. So you get to see what the producers do. You get to see what the development directors do. You get to see what the programmers are doing and the artists are doing. And so you are working with the team. So I would look for those jobs. There's not as many of them, but those are the best ones to get into.
Yeah. I don't want to say every studio, but we're going to have, a core of half dozen people in QA, who are going to be our QA leads, basically, who are going to be there as long as the studio's around. They're the people we build our larger testing team around. And you're right, at the end of projects, often contractors get laid off. You know, it's just a fact of life. But the best ones, you know, we find a way to keep them. I had a talk with one of my testers today saying, you know, hey, keep it up. You're well on the road to a production slot. I mean, he's just shown that he can handle that kind of work. He's organized. He's willing to do whatever it takes. I mean, whatever needs to be done, he'll do it. Doesn't matter how menial or not fun it is. He'll just do whatever needs to be done to get that game done. And there's nothing more important for a producer. You have to be willing to do whatever the team needs. That's what you are. You're the guy who makes sure the team gets what it needs, you know? Period. End of story. If you're one of the people who's part of that small local testing group, you'll have ample opportunity to show what you're made of and what your design sensibilities are and what kinds of bugs you write up and can you communicate them clearly and can you track them down and are you willing to be there at 4 a.m. when, you know, we need you there and all that good stuff. So again, it's just a great way to prove that you have the passion that Pat was mm-hmm. talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And the best ones don't get laid off. I mean, it's as simple as that.
You keep the best ones.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Another question? Yeah.
You said that the vision was like a small part of a huge like Disney machine. Do you think that, you know, do you think there's some sort of, you know, restrictions on creative freedom, or is it pretty much just like, you know, as long as you make, say, like a Hannah Montana game, like anything goes as to, you know, what it ends up becoming?
Okay, so what was the question?
How constraining is Disney on vision?
And vision?
I think is the simple answer.
Yeah,
the simple
yeah. Well, I guess it depends what you're working on, isn't it? If you're working on a Disney title, you know, then there's going to be, you know, certain ways that Disney wants it to be projected out to the general public. But there is freedom within that as well. And there is a freedom to sort of interpret things. Interpret a Disney property a little bit differently. So we go through a very long review process to get to where we green light a project. And lots of ideas are thrown around. And some of them may be really out there, just absolutely out there. And then we might bring them in a little bit, and maybe a little bit more. And maybe we might stop, or might bring them a little more. I don't know. But it's the important thing is to get all those ideas out there so people can see what would make the game really fun and really fabulous. So, and then there's the IP division, you know, where you're making new IP. There's really no limitations on there, except Disney does not do restricted games. They'll stop at the mature market. So, and we don't do sports either.
And yeah, I mean, every publisher imposes constraints.
Yeah.
You know, Bob Iger said recently that no Disney thing of any kind will portray smoking. Is that a constraint that anybody should care about? That would be a big no. You know, I mean, who cares really? If you can't be creative without cigarettes, you know, forget it. I mean, maybe you need them like yourself, but on the screen, we really don't need that to be creative.
Yeah.
You know, but you can see there's. That Turok is not what you would expect to be coming from Disney. So,
and the Pirates movie. I mean, the whole thing about the Pirates, that was really pushing the edges of entertainment for kids.
Worked pretty well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was sort of struck by how, like, I don't know, I just kept thinking LucasArts and how they sort of do their game division and in regards, because, like, It seemed to me there was a time when there were sort of like 50-50 like movie properties and 50-50 like completely original, and I'm sort of wondering what Disney's vision is in the game industry, I guess.
The big goal is to be one of the top five publishers, and so that's where we want to be. And it's going to take time to get there. You know, considering we started with a small group of only like 150 people, and we keep growing. So for us to get there in terms of what games we make and what revenue it makes, we've got a ways to go. But it is possible, and that is what the big goal is.
And I think Pat said earlier, I mean, the breakdown is 70%.
I think it's
based
80,
on Disney
80, 20,
IP 20, 20, 10, 70, 20, 10,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah, yeah.
So Disney's a branding machine,
yeah.
Right? I mean, and they know it. It's where their bread is buttered. Why wouldn't you exploit that?
Yeah.
So that's where a lot of the effort is going to go. 20%, you know,
right.
Is going to be for a little more exploration, and 10% is completely new stuff.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, I gave the keynote design talk at the Game Developers Conference about 3 years ago about sequels and licenses. And if we have some speakers fall off the schedule here, you'll get to hear that talk before we're done. And it's a pretty good talk, I think. Anyway, you know, you can be creative in the context of pretty much any IP constraints. You know, constraints are where creativity happens. It's not like... Not like, yeah, I mean, many of you are RTF students. It's not like John Ford, you know, and Michael Curtiz and those guys operated, you know, I just want to make art. You know, no. You know, the Louis B. Mayer told them what to do. Jack Warner told them what to do. And they made some of the best movies ever made.
Mm-hmm.
So there's plenty of room for creativity in the context of a license or a sequel if you're clever and creative enough to find that spark, you know, what makes that license worth exploiting.
And what is, where is the creativity? Is it in the gameplay? Is it in some of the features? You know, there's, if you look at the different products, you'll see something innovative in each one of them.
You attended my talk.
I know, yeah. That actually, I didn't. But, but you know, one of the things I want I was too busy recruiting. If you look at Turok, for instance, like, look at the way the grass moves. And when you see that, and that's very, really innovative and pushing it. Look at dino mauling. I'm not going to tell you what dino mauling is, but go look it up, kind of what the dino mauling is and the luring and things. So those are all like new things and very creative. And I remember I was around those guys when they were first coming up with some of this stuff, and it was everything they thought of you couldn't possibly put in the game. It just wasn't possible. So watch for Turok 2, because there'll be some of that in there. And then we also have us in the company. You can take out patents, and if you take out patents, you'll get rewards from the company for doing patents for things. So that's looking for, again, improving technology.
Yeah. What do you look for? You said the Disney acquired the Turok guys after just they'd been out of EA for a few months.
Yes.
What do you look for in new studios to acquire?
Each one's different. You know, absolutely different. What it brings to the table. I mean, those guys that they brought is they had been wildly successful in the games that they'd made before. You know, they had made some new and innovative games for their previous employer, which was well known. And then just when the company was meeting with them, they thought, these guys know how to make a game. It's obvious. So it was a risk. It was definitely a risk to take it on. But it certainly has proved to be, now when Turok was released, there's no doubt, absolutely no doubt, it was the right decision to do. So it was, I think everybody just recognized right away that the level of talent that was in the room. So what you look for is different. It wanted Avalanche and that group because they've been making the games that are associated with the films for a while, and it just made sense to let's start making them internally because then we can control the creative a little more. So that's one of the reasons for that.
No idea why they bought me.
I do, but I want to make his head big.
Too late.
From sort of a human resources perspective,
yeah.
You talked about you were at EA, and I was just curious what your take is on the whole, you know, our industry is very tough on the employees and the people who work in it, and I don't know if you were there for the whole EA spouse thing, but...
That was after I had left, yeah. But that, you're talking about sort of the work-life balance and lack thereof. Yeah, I mean, the industry, it's a hard-working industry, absolutely. The one thing that we, in Disney, that we're really aware of is we don't want people to be killing themselves over this. I mean, this is not an industry where we're saving lives. You know, this is the entertainment business. So it's need to keep that perspective in there. And that an employee or somebody or who employee cast member or whatever, you know, is... works that hard, you lose your perspective, and you're going to make mistakes, and you're not going to be very happy, and you're going to be tired. So those things we're really, really aware of. We do have a crunch period. When you're making a game, there is always that down to the wire, we're heading towards the goal line, and we just got to keep plowing and get there. But the goal is to make that shorter. Some companies, that finaling period can be 9 months of the year, and that's brutal. So you want to make that a whole lot shorter so that people will have a life. And we do encourage that. So it's the industry where you can be flexible as long as we can fit into the schedule. It all takes, this is one of the biggest differences that I have found over the years, is now that we're bringing in people who do have the education background behind them, who do have really good business skills and project skills, and that they can plan a project out better and tighter than we could have in the past with not having those skills.
Anything else? Okay. Well, why don't we take a 10-minute break, and we'll come back, and you get to listen to me talk for a while. But thanks, Pat, for giving these guys a break and telling us a lot about getting into the game business. So we had a surprise guest. We had a surprise guest, but I actually did have some stuff I wanted to talk about, and so I'm going to try and rip through a three-hour talk in 2 hours. We'll see how I do. I'm probably editing on the fly. That's always a scary thing for me. Well, scary for you. It's actually not so scary for me. The other thing I have to warn you about is I forgot to bring the power supply for my laptop, so that if I run out of juice, this could get really interesting. So this is basically my agenda for the night. I wanted to try and do my version of your assignment. I didn't think it would be fair to ask you guys to do something, especially something that's kind of fun, you know, and not do it myself. So I'm going to go through my 10 favorite games. I posted a little bit of this on my blog recently, but there's a lot more here, probably than they want. And then talk about what happens if we apply different criteria, what does the list look like, and then talk about some really radically different criteria and what the list looks like. And then after that, I got some other stuff we'll talk about as well. All right, so my criteria, when I think about my favorite games, you know, honestly, I don't think about it all that much. It's favorites, right? So what's fun? What gave me the most pleasure? What did I get obsessed about and not realize
12 hours had passed since I, you know, got up and you know, washed myself or anything, you know. You know, personal significance. So which games came along at particular moments in my life that were really meaningful? I mean, I think back on certain games, which we'll talk about here in a little while, and they represent big moments for me in my life. So that's part of the criterion. You know, there are games that brought me closer to my family and friends. I mean, I'm probably married today because I play Tested Tune with my wife, my now wife, you know? Which games changed the way I think about games? And which games changed what I do for a living? And then, for me, one of the most important criteria is, which games do I still want to play now? Which games do I go back to and still play years after I first played them? So here's my list. You know, it's in chronological order except for Tetris. I think Tetris deserves special mention because it is probably the best game of all time in some sense, and I'll talk about why I think that is. After that, it's chronological. And in fact, I do still go back and play all of these, either for pleasure or as research, or for, you know, just to remind myself why I do what I do for a living. You'll notice that, several people have noticed that none of the games I worked on are on this list. That's on purpose. I don't think it's really appropriate to, you know, pat yourself on the back quite that hard. You may also notice that none of the games here are like the games I actually make, which is kind of weird. You know, the reason for that is pretty simple. I mean, the games that I make, when I play a game that's sort of like what I do for a living, you know, Bioshock is kind of a kissing cousin, Half-Life is kind of a kissing cousin, although that's on the list. You know, the stuff that Bethesda does, Oblivion, is kind of a kissing cousin of what I do for a living. When I play those games, the problem is I find myself obsessing about the ways in which I would have done it differently. And that immediately pulls me out of the experience. I can't really just get to it as a fan. Maybe it's a failing in me, I don't know. So I tend not to enjoy playing games that are sort of like the games I make as much as I like playing games that are exceptionally well executed, versions of things that I would never do myself. Your mileage may vary. The other thing you may notice here is that most of these games are pretty old. It's probably because I'm pretty old, too. But also partly because I think a game really has to stand the test of time. I mean, right now, you know, Bioshock is clearly the critic's darling, and deservedly so. But 10 years from now, how are we going to feel about it? 20 years from now, how are we going to feel about it? Unclear. The games on my personal favorites list are all games that have stood the test of time. I can and do go back and play these every couple of years and still get pleasure out of them. So that's kind of why it looks the way it does. So let's start with Tetris, okay? Okay, let me ask you a simple question. How many other 23-year-old games are you still playing? The answer would be none, okay? Okay, now we can move on to the next game. No, but I mean, that's pretty much the bottom line. I mean, it's a game that came out, 20 years ago, sorry. And we're still playing it. We still play it on every platform. I have it on my cell phone right this minute. I have a little keychain at home that has it. I mean, it's everywhere. Beyond that, in the same way that, you know, it's inevitable we're going to talk about Dungeons & Dragons because I'm a geek, okay? But, you know, the whole business owes a debt to Gary Gygax and Dave Arneson. And in the same way, the entire casual games market owes its existence, I think, to Tetris. You know, I kind of feel guilty talking about it just because it's so ubiquitous and it's so easy to identify it as you know, one of the most important games of all time. You know, the bottom line, I mean, is that it really is ubiquitous. There have been, you know, puzzles and wristwatches and board games, and more board games, and shelves, okay? There are Tetris shelves. It is completely timeless and completely ubiquitous, okay? That alone justifies its existence on my list. But if that was enough, the history of the game is unbelievable. Now, I almost put it on the reading list. I talked about this. There's a book called Game Over by David Sheff. Pick it up. You can find it in a half-price book. If you don't want to buy it new, you should buy it new. But the history of this game is crazy. I'm not going to go through it now, but it's a textbook case of the power of individual creativity crushed by corporate greed. No, I mean, you know, it really is a case study in everything that's interesting and important about the game business. And every lesson that Alexei Pajitnov, honestly, I don't know how to pronounce the man's name, I apologize. But everything that he went through is the kind of stuff that creators and developers go through now. It's crazy. I strongly recommend picking up Game Over and reading that. Talking much further than that would really take up the whole, 3 hours, and I only have two, so we're going to keep going. Last week we talked about the core characteristics of the medium, and this is a game that truly embodies all of those characteristics. Tetris could not have existed in any other medium. I mean, yes, there are board game adaptations. Do any of you play them? Have you ever played them? Did you even know they existed? Right, there you go. Oh, we got one. It's kind of hard to see because it's kind of dark. But basically, this game could only exist. It has all those things. I mean, again, not to go into too much detail, but it's got the characteristic of could only have been done in this medium. No two games play out alike. It's real-time. Action is driven by player choice. You decide where to maneuver those pieces. There's the random element, of course. But you decide where to move those pieces, how to maneuver them, where to put them for maximum effect. Lots of player intentionality in Tetris. It is basically a perfect design. I mean, it's exquisitely balanced to be short duration, high satisfaction. I'm just going to play one more. I mean, it's like the crack cocaine of video games. Not that I would know. Anyway. It's simple. I mean, that's the thing that's beautiful about it. Any of you guys could in Java create your own version of Tetris today. There's nothing high-tech about it. It is pure game, okay? And a little editorial comment at the end, which we will move on from. It created a new genre, which is one of my key criteria for sort of significance, which we'll come back to. The real-time dynamic puzzle, which is what Tetris is, it was the first. It spawned a bunch of imitators, created a whole new thing. Okay, so that's Tetris. That's why it's on the list. Mule. Anybody remember Mule? Oh gosh. Okay, there are a bunch of emulators out there. You can play Mule. You gotta play Mule. You gotta play Mule. You gotta play Mule. I don't care if it's a 24-year-old game, and the graphics are kind of crazy. This was made by Dan Bunten, who became Dani Bunten, in one of the industry's stranger and more amazing stories. It was swell. Single player, this game was amazing. But it was multiplayer. You had to take a turn sitting at the keyboard, but it was transcendent as a multiplayer game. The fact that nobody's done a multiplayer version is just insane. You want a great project? Do a quickie multiplayer ripoff of Mule, and I guarantee that Sony and Microsoft will put it out there, and you will make a ton of money. Why don't I do that? Basically, it was a board game translated to the screen, but it had, in the upper right there of the screen, you selected your character, and each character had different capabilities. It had a real-time component in that you had to go out and capture territory, decide which territories you wanted. You had some idea of what resources those territories would generate, and that was you had to select in real time. So there's this time pressure, this ticking clock, as your time to select a place is running out. You produce resources. There were things you could spend your resources on. You could even gamble if you wanted. And then there was an amazing real time, four player interactive bartering system, because you couldn't produce everything. You couldn't get enough land to produce everything yourself, which meant you were dependent on your fellow players. Okay, so real-time stress, limited resource production, the ability to trade with other players, and the necessity to play to trade with other players in real time, and that real-time trading thing, it was so cool. You had so many ways of screwing your friends. It was unbelievable, and that's one of the critical things about great games. You must be able to screw your friends. So, and trust me when I say that, I screwed a lot of friends playing this game. We played a lot. We were in the same room together. It brought us closer together, not further apart. And for that reason alone, I think it deserves a place on the list. And I'm really not kidding. Go out there tonight, search for Mule, or search for Dani Bunten, find an emulated version, and play it. And if you don't like it, don't tell me. Okay, next on the list, Ultima 4. As a player, I was absolutely transfixed by this game. At the time it came out, I was still making tabletop games. At that point I was working at Steve Jackson Games, I guess. And I had a lot of experience creating role-playing adventures and collaborating with players and the telling of stories, all that stuff we talked about last week. As a computer game player, though, as a video game player at that time, all I felt like I'd been offered, leaving the Infocom text adventures out of the picture, but in terms of graphically oriented games, all I'd ever been offered was the opportunity to slay a bunch of monsters, collect a bunch of treasure, and get really bored really fast. And then along came this game. And Richard is going to come in here, or I will... Anyway, he's coming in. And we'll talk more about what motivated him to make this game. But the critical thing about this was the first game I ever played that told me, you know, games can be more than just about killing monsters. They can give players more freedom than I ever thought was possible. Richard had a vision that changed the way I thought about video games. And it had some real ethical underpinnings. I mean, you had to behave like the avatar. You had to become the avatar. You had to make ethical choices constantly. And this was the game that made me want to get out of tabletop games and help create a new medium. Okay. Let's take a moment to appreciate the finest game ever made anywhere on any platform, with possible exception of Tetris. If you force me to pick my favorite game of all time, this is it. I play this game about once a year. It's amazing. It never bores me. I'm doing the same things over and over again. It's just crazy. I don't even understand it, really. I think Tetris would win my Desert Island Sweepstakes game because you can play it over and over and over again. I mean, over and over again. But this game, in terms of storytelling and feeling like a hero, it's an absolute jewel. It is exciting. It is visually, it's pretty enough, you know? It has these wonderful, iconic little characters that you just kind of care about. Because, they look sort of like infants, and, you know, you want to protect them and stuff. The game balance is perfect. It has simple controls, great sound. I mean, it's got everything for me. And again, this is another game that it's, 15 years old now. And I just downloaded it and play on my Wii now. I mean, this is available on every platform. It still speaks to people today. How many people have played this? Oh, yeah. How many people? No, don't admit that you haven't. I don't want to know. It's available on every platform. Go play it. Because it really is like a fine diamond. I mean, it's simple and wonderful. And someone earlier said Chrono Trigger was their favorite game. And occasionally Chrono Trigger shows up on my list. But this game, this is the game. This is my Chrono Trigger. It's fantastic. Oh my god. I didn't get to meet Shigeru Miyamoto. I was at E3 and I got this close to him and I couldn't bring myself to say anything. I was totally like fanboy geek out. It was unbelievable. I should have said hello. Okay. All right. Warcraft 2. I couldn't pick which one I liked better, which one I thought deserved to be on the list. The reason this is on the list is because not because it was the first or even the best real-time strategy game, but because it's the only game that's ever made me laugh and sweat at the same time. You know, I think people played Warcraft, a Warcraft RTS. Okay, all I have to do is say "zugzug," and we're over. It's done. You know, we always start laughing. I mean, I love the game. Gameplay was solid. You know, the artwork was terrific. There's more personality in those little units than there is in the most detailed, beautifully rendered characters in most games today. Multiplayer was a revelation, this game, with the possible exception of Command & Conquer, which we will come to. This game almost destroyed Origin. I mean, holy cow, we played a whole lot of this game. And again, I mean, we see the power of iconic graphics. There's so many things to love about it. But on a non-personal note, the fact that this is the game that put Blizzard on the map and created the world that became World of Warcraft, and gave them resources and clout to make things like StarCraft, and to tackle and dominate the MMO space, got to be on anybody's list as far as I'm concerned. Okay, yes. How many people have heard of this game? Okay, smaller group. I would not say that everybody should rush out and play Sweet. And if you're going to play a Sweet game, make sure it's the first one if you can afford it. No. One is way too. Anyway, we can argue that later. I'm probably the only person in the world who considers this a great game. And it's weird because I usually hate traditional Japanese RPGs. I mean, the last Final Fantasy I played was Final Fantasy VII. I got about halfway through it and I just went, oh my god, I can't do this anymore. I mean, all that crazy party building and turn-based combat, random battles, oh my god, you know, that crazy spell. I mean, I think you could do your taxes by creating a party in most Japanese RPGs. There's a spreadsheet working in there that's sophisticated enough to do your taxes. And I really just can't stand, just so you know, I'm not shy about expressing my prejudices. I don't know if that's a good thing. I hate games that give you story, combat, and only give you any intention and ability to plan anybody to do anything in those combat parts. I hate that. And yet, Sweden does all of that. And yet, it's on my top 10 list. Go figure. Okay, so why is that? First, there's this recruiting system, right? I mean, those of you who played it know that there are all these characters out there that you can recruit or not, right? And the characters you should recruit, they determine, to some extent, your ability to participate and succeed in mass battles. Okay, so recruiting, you decide who you recruit. They determine your abilities in mass battles. That alone is really freaking cool, okay? It's a ton of fun. It gives me a way to express myself as a player that most Japanese RPGs do not provide. And beyond that, they show up at this base, this castle, okay, that starts out a complete wreck. It's a hunk of rock. And by the end of the game, it is populated by the people you have chosen to bring here. It has been made beautiful by these people. It expresses who you are because the people you bring there set up shop and start selling you the things that are unique to them, which are the things that you have told the game you want in your experience. It's fantastic. I've been trying to get a home base like that, just rip these guys off, you know, for years. And it's always the first thing that gets frustrating. Okay, so someday I'm going to make a game that's all about the home base. But that is unbelievably cool, and no one has done it as well as Suikoden did in the first game. And finally, here's the real reason it's on the list. The conversation system, it's dirt simple. I mean, it's been long enough since I've played this, to be completely honest. I can't remember if, my memory of it may be faulty. Okay, so if it is, one of you guys, I'm sure, will correct me. It's like there's no interaction in conversations. It's just they tell you what the characters tell you what they're gonna say and little scenes like that in the upper right, and then you move on. It's linear, non-interactive stuff. But every once in a while, a character comes up on the screen. I think this happened twice in the game. First they give you these big choices. I mean, a character comes up and says something, and you just go, whoa. If I answer that, it's going to say more about me as a human being than about my character or how I want this game to unfold. Okay, and that just stopped me dead in my tracks the first time I played this. The first time, there's this little punk, a little punk character who's like following you around, getting in the way, and being really annoying at the beginning of the game. And then there's this huge battle which you can't win. And you have no control over it. You're fighting this dragon, and it's just really kicking your butt. And you end up, this character, this pain in the neck that you just want to kick out of your party and get rid of, he jumps in the line of fire and takes mortal damage to save your life. And okay, that's, yeah, whatever. It's just a bunch of pixels, right? Who cares? So then, he ends up in bed back at this inn where you're staying. And there are all these conversations where he says, I'm your best friend, remember? I'm best friend, I'm your best friend. He says for like half an hour how he's your best friend. I just want to kill him. And then some bad guys show up. And you're there, and you're about to go into battle, you think. And this punk kid who saved your life and has been telling you for half an hour to the point where it's just beaten into your head that it's true, he's your best friend. And he basically, I'm not an actor, okay, but he basically says, you go. You have important things to do. I'll hold these guys off. And it's like there's a yes-no choice. Do you stay and jeopardize your truly important world-saving mission, or do you leave your best friend who sacrificed himself for you? And it's like, I had never been offered that kind of choice in a game before, okay? That was pretty cool. And then later in the game, you end up, without revealing too much, because none of you will play this thing, you end up on opposite sides of a conflict with your father, okay, who has been basically a quest object, you know, for a long time. And you meet him, and you realize he is now your enemy. And there comes a point where there's a conversation, and the choice is do you fight your father? Y-N. Whoa. You know? And as stupid as it sounds, when you've invested hours, and I mean hours of play into this thing, that moment, those moments just, they literally changed the way I thought about games. When I got done with this, I could no more consider, you know, Ultima fans will know what I'm talking about, name, job, buy, you know, conversation systems that give you trivial choices that are completely irrelevant, uninteresting, and not particularly revelatory of anything, let alone your personal character. When I played Suikoden, my whole world changed. The kinds of games I wanted to make changed. And it was all a result of some punk kid who I wanted to kick in the butt, who made me decide if I was going to help him, you know, survive or not. It's pretty cool stuff. Okay. This is not the short version of this thing. Oh well. Okay, Super Mario 64. It is not possible to squeeze that much gameplay out of so few character abilities and that little graphical punch and onto a silly cartridge. Holy cow. This is a game that has inspired and intimidated and been ripped off by more developers than any other game. There are so many reasons. I mean, holy cow. For one thing, no game has ever done a better job of showing you goals before you get to them, and before you can even attain them. That's one of the, I mean, it's one of the stupid little things that as a game developer you have to figure out how to do. You always show the goal so players can make a plan about how to get there. You always show the goal before they're capable of reaching it to sort of entice them to keep moving towards it, okay? I didn't even know this until recently, but the Imagineers at Disney have a word for it. They call that a weenie. At the theme park, there's always something you can see that is drawing you on. And games are all about that. Super Mario 64 did it better than any other game. This is a game where you explore the same space over and over again. And I was talking about this with some guys earlier. A game that allows you to re-explore the same space and make it interesting every time, pretty damn cool. The reward schedule is perfect. You gain new abilities just at the moment where you're feeling like, all right, I'm kind of slogging through this. I need something new to do. I mean, even the save load scheme is terrific. You know, failure in this game just means you give up a little bit of territory. You retraverse some space that is still interesting to you. But you don't lose any of the real progress. I mean, there's real progress to be made in this game. The collection of stars, and you never lose any of that. Any developer would have killed to make this. Any gamer would love to play it. Just a fantastic game. I mean, this is a graduate education in game design. And probably Miyamoto's, maybe Link. You know, Link to the Past is his finest moment. But this is right up there. Diablo. Okay, how many people played Diablo? Okay, that's pretty good. Has there ever been a sound as rewarding as the sort of chinging as gold drops on the ground? I get a little line of saliva right here every time a ring hits the ground in Diablo. I mean, it is the perfect Pavlovian behavioral psychology experiment. And that might sound like a bad thing, but it's actually not. I mean, one of the things that designers, I think, really need to understand, that kind of comes as a surprise, they need to have some understanding of economics, and they have to have a fairly, an education in psychology. They really need to understand psychology, because there's all sorts of stuff that we do all the time like Skinner would have loved and Pavlov would have loved. So reward schedules and, the way they used sound to cue you about what's going on, their feedback is amazing. The randomized dungeon means that every playthrough is different. The graphics I thought were simple but swell. In Diablo 2 they introduced a skill system that actually does contribute to differentiating characters and differentiating the way you solve some problems in the game. The fact you can play with other players is like the cherry on top of the dessert. I have to say that though I would call Diablo my favorite game of all time, it's probably wasted more of my time. I mean, I still play it all the time. It's kind of scary. Okay, Half-Life. It got there first with shooters, but for me, Half-Life was the game that really, really changed things. The fact that this was their first game, Valve's first game, is absolutely terrifying to me. To this day, it's terrifying. I mean, it was one of the most professionally produced, best tuned game experiences around. And I still hate the G-Man. I still hate that guy. There was a little misstep at the end when it turned into Gordon Freeman goes to Mario World and there are all these jumping puzzles. I mean, what the heck were they thinking? But it was Valve's first game, so you kind of have to cut him some slack. For me personally, I much prefer Half-Life to Half-Life 2. I'm still hoping I can get a guy from Valve down here to argue about that. We'll see if it happens. And then Guitar Hero. Okay, I'm really not going to talk much about this other than it was made by a bunch of friends of mine. I love them. They deserve all the success that they've had. The music is great. I want to be a rock star. It fulfills that fantasy. And that's my mother-in-law and my father-in-law playing in the middle picture. And that's all you really need to know about why this is on my list. I mean, any game that can get a roughly 70-year-old man and woman playing a video game, that's okay in my book. She was rocking out, I'll tell you. Okay, an honorable mention. It amazes me that I like this game. I hate adventure games like this. I hate puzzle games like this. But this one was perfect. It was perfectly executed. The puzzles are exceptionally well designed. The environments, I should have thrown up some screenshots. I mean, it's still one of the prettiest games I've ever seen. For all you RTF majors in the audience, how many RTF majors are here? How many of you have played this game? Okay, you should all play this game. If you're an RTF major and you have any interest at all in video games, you need to play this. And I'll say that because when I first played it, the camera work seemed wrong to me. I mean, I was an RTF guy. You know, I made a bunch of movies. I have some sense of how movies work, how they should be directed and cut. And the reality is, I watched this game and it was frustrating as hell because the camera would move like just a little bit further than I thought it should, or it would come up a little bit too high to a very awkward position, or it would swing around in a position that made no sense to me. And after a while, I figured out why. And it's because the camera is being used to reveal elements of puzzles. Not necessarily the puzzle you're engaged in right now. The camera moves just enough to reveal something that you're going to have to be doing in 15 minutes. And it's always in the perfect place to do that. So while for a film it might be off, for a film it might look wrong, for a video game it was perfect. And as soon as I twigged to that, I started using the camera became a tool. It wasn't just an impediment or a frustration. It was a tool I could use to help me navigate through this world. And that was really powerful because we'll talk about this more too. Camera is huge in video games. Okay, it was one of the toughest problems we faced. And Eco used the camera as well as any game I can remember. Story is completely trite. I mean, again, it's about this outcast young lad who has to save a princess. And the whole game is about protecting that princess. I mean, you're literally, you take her by the virtual hand. I guess that can't be really literal, but you take her by the hand, you drag her around, and she's slower than you are, and she can't fight, and it's really frustrating. But after a while, I mean, you start feeling this. I mean, this is a magic moment in a game. I had never felt anything like that. I have never felt anything since that was as powerful as that virtual touch. And I would kill to do something that has that quality, that isn't a direct ripoff. And if I were smarter, I'd figure out what that thing is. I gotta find some way to recapture that feeling and give that to other people. And you really start feeling something for that character because of that verbal touch. But then, I'm getting chills just thinking about it. How many people have played this? Again, tell me again. Okay. Okay, I'm gonna try to reveal, I'm not gonna reveal anything critical, but there comes a point in the game where there's an incredible turnaround. And this girl who's been frustration and getting you killed and really annoying you, and you've got to drag her around and help her get... Anyway, she turns around and does something absolutely awe-inspiring. And it's one of the most magic moments in a game. It is... I mean, I still get chills thinking about it. And the fact that it didn't sell worth a damn is a crime. I mean, and it did, as far as I understand. But it's still a terrific game. So there you go. All right. So that's my favorite list. Those are the games that I go back to and play over and over and over again. But let's sort of change the criteria a little bit. I want to talk about a best list. And for me, given how young this medium is, you know, it's not like we can really say, okay, this survived for 20 years. Because, you know, back, if you did that in 1910, nobody even remembers the movies that are the best of 1910. I mean, it's just 20 years is not enough to have any kind of critical perspective on what's going to be important in the future. But we can talk about the things that have significance. I don't give a damn about fun for this list. The game of being fun is irrelevant. It's a meaningless word. It's one that we probably should ban from our discussions in this class. But certainly for this list, not useful. So I'm looking for influence. I'm looking for games that changed things, right? So here's my best list, somewhat different. A lot of honorable mentions too, man. Getting this down to 10 was tough. And this is, again, in chronological order. This one is literally in chronological order. Anyway, let me just run through it. Okay. So, Star Raiders. How many people have played Star Raiders? Right. How many people remember Star Raiders? Know anything about it? Oh, this is going to be good. Okay. This is the personal significance aspect of this. Before we get to the real significance is, I used to hang out with a bunch of local science fiction writers and, you know, adults, people who are... That's okay. There's going to be sound here in a minute. I went to a party at a friend's house, right? All adults. A couple of people who worked for the state government, a couple of people who worked for city government, a bunch of people from UT, the folks who now are the staff of the Chronicle were there. I mean, a lot of grad students. We're all there, and I walk in, and there are 25 of these folks all gathered around a 25-inch television, which at the time was really freaking big, okay? And they're looking at this. I mean, the only light was the phosphor dots of the TV, you know? And this is, you know, I walked in and I heard this. Never heard anything like that before. And this. And this. And saw images like that. And I'm as okay, you guys are all thinking I'm insane now, I know it. But you have to remember, this was 1979. This was on an Atari 800. I mean, I was dead at this moment. I was a hardcore, play D&D twice a week while, you know, like flunking out of grad school. You know, and D&D lost its luster for me. I mean, the text adventures we were playing were history. It was just absolutely life-changing. It was a video game that took itself seriously. And more importantly, it put me in the cockpit. It was a first-person game. Instead of, you know, like watching Luke Skywalker and Star Wars, I was that guy, and for the very first time, okay? So here, this is what it actually looked like. Let me play with it. Oh wow, that's blown up way too big. Oh well, it looked a little better than this. Perhaps we'll move on. Anyway, yeah, we'll move on. Sorry about that. If anybody's really interested, I can resize that. Okay, but this was the world's first ever space combat. Okay. There have been some turn-based strategy games. I used to work at the Texan down here, and we used to play Star Trek, you know, when we were goofing off on their little mainframes or whatever we had back then. And there have been action games, like Space War, which we'll talk very briefly about in a while. But this was something new. This was the first simulation of space combat. It was the first time strategy had met action and then come together. It really did have terrific graphics. I know you can't believe it. Okay, wait for it. The first 3D game ever. Okay, this was the first time anybody had done a 3D game. Period. All right. Imagine that. I mean, the revelation that was to people who had never seen anything like it before. If you can find that perspective in your mind, it did spawn a new genre. I mean, there have been plenty of imitators. You could argue that any Elite, Wing Commander, X-Wing versus TIE, any of those might have actually happened if not for Starfighters, but I'm not sure about that. It certainly expressed those core characteristics that we talked about last week. I mean, it sure transported me. It sure immersed me in that other world. It was me in that Starfighter, you know? Anyway, I know how hard it is to put yourself in the mindset of someone, you know, that long ago, when you're used to BioShock and Gears of War and all that, but this was the first. Star Raiders is where all of that stuff started. It's unclear that any of us would be here today if not for that. And again, this was 1983. This was someone looking back from a you know, somewhat closer time frame. We experienced the thrill of space travel for the very first time, and back then those visual effects were very real. Okay. So that's a game of huge significance. And by the way, the fact that none of you know about it and none of you have seen it is exactly why we need to start preserving our history before it's lost. I mean, I won't go on that rant, but we're all lucky that we're affiliated with the University of Texas, which is really getting behind the idea of a video game archive. And if you're interested in hearing more about that, we can talk at some other time. So then there's Ultima 4. I'm not going to talk about that, it's significant. Does go beyond just sort of giving me pleasure and changing the way I think about games. It really did change the way a lot of people thought about games back then. So it crossed over both lists. Sim whatever. I mean, take your pick. I could just put Will Wright's picture up there. You know, the bottom line is, if I proposed SimCity, I would have been laughed out of every publisher on the planet. Will's ability to take seemingly unfun things and then make them intensely fun is just beyond belief. And SimCity, it's still one of the finest examples of open-ended gameplay, of freeform sandbox gameplay. It's absolutely player-driven in every way that matters. SimCity, it begat, Sim everything else, right? I mean, how many God games have there been since then? How many imitators have come along? No one's ever been able to do it quite as well, but the fact that it spawned The Sims, which was the most successful PC franchise around, that's pretty good stuff. I think we'd have to say that the Will Wright collection deserves a spot on the list. Okay, I don't need to say anything more. Doom. I could have picked Wolfenstein. I could have been a little more eurocentric and said Underworld shift before Wolfenstein, but whatever. Doom was the first game that really cracked the sort of mainstream consciousness. It was the first game that showed up, product placement wise on sitcoms. It's the first game that got mentioned in congressional hearings, not always in a good way. In fact, never in a good way. It was everywhere. I mean, it was a great single-player game, for sure. And then, basically, created online gaming. okay, that's kind of important. Basically created the mods community. That's kind of important. Safe to say that a substantial percentage of game developers got their start either, well, certainly playing, but creating mods for Doom. You know, I don't know that any game comes close to having the level of influence that Doom did on the world, frankly. It's pretty amazing. Myst. Anybody remember Myst? Yeah, okay, sure. Okay. Important because it was one of the first CD games. I mean, we were all trying to figure out at Origin, what the heck do we do with a CD, you know? And the Rand brothers figured it out. Let's put lots and lots of prettier pictures than anybody's ever seen on that CD. They upped the ante in terms of production values in a way that, you know, you could argue has been damaging, but also you could argue reached a whole new audience. It had beautiful graphics. It had a slower pace than traditional games. It had a pretty deep storyline and maybe most important, you know, non-violent interaction, which made it okay for non-gamers to play games. This was probably the first time that was true. Non-gamers had a reason to play games. That attracted mainstream attention at a level that, you know, we didn't get very often. It was the first time I think people started thinking, hey, maybe this is an art form, you know? And frankly, it's only recently that we've been able to create images that rival it just for you know, sheer beauty, I guess. So Myst has to make the list. I mean, commercial success, again, huge. Command & Conquer, already talked about Warcraft, which was, I mean, I enjoy Warcraft more. I find Command & Conquer's like deadly seriousness. I mean, I guess maybe I'm overstating, but it just seems too serious. And it's all that, you know, cinematic stuff that's kind of goofy. You could even argue that Dune 2, which predated this as the first real-time strategy game, should be the game on the list. But this game almost destroyed the game business because, boy, if Warcraft and Doom occupied a lot of time, this one, I mean, you don't even want to know how many hours of Command & Conquer I played with Richard Garriott and Tony Zerbetter, the guy who's the project director on Crusader, and the general manager at Oracle. I mean, everybody played this game. It kind of made RTS games, for a while, one of the most popular genres around. Nowadays, it's mostly ensemble that's kind of carrying the torch, but the historical significance of this game really can't be denied. Hey, look, get some Mario. Okay, let me add one thing here, now that we're talking about significance, as opposed to just sort of personal, I love this game, 11 million units sold. Okay, there you go. It was the first time that anybody really tried to adapt side-scrolling gameplay to a 3D environment, a real 3D environment. And that has changed gaming pretty dramatically. I mean, the Ratchet & Clanks and Banjo-Kazooies and, you know, you name it, of the world are direct descendants of Super Mario. Ultima Online. It almost doesn't seem fair. Richard is just too damn creative. I mean, it's bad enough that he changed the world with Ultima 4 a little bit, and, you know, changed it again probably with Ultima 6, and probably definitely changed it with Ultima Online. You know, he basically what Rich did was he took the sort of mush, moo, mud, niche-y craziness and made it commercially viable. And let me tell you, you want to talk about, someone asked about creative constraints. Holy cow, did Electronic Arts not get this. Holy cow, did Richard have to fight every single day. Man, did everybody at Origin have to fight to keep this game from getting killed. It was crazy. They didn't get, no one did. I mean, it's not a knock on them. Richard saw something in the massively multiplayer online role-playing game that no one else did. He ran with it. He saw the power of community before anybody else did. His team, of course. You know, there have been marriages that came out of this, divorces, friendships, all sorts of amazing things. It certainly spawned a host of imitators. You know, one or two of them may be superior, but certainly most of them inferior. And it wouldn't be too much of a stretch, I think, to say that World of Warcraft is around today and is successful because this game existed. You know, and a little closer to home, you know, it's unclear that Austin would have a thriving game development community if not for Ultima Online. We were a kind of a single-player PC world with not much going on in terms of console development. And then out of the blue comes this thing, and all of a sudden, you know, we are a mecca of online gaming. If you went to the Austin Game Developers Conference, I hope most of you did anyway, that game's focus reflects Austin's strengths. And our strength, though, Disney Interactive Studios is going to change that. That is certainly changing. And we've got Retro, we've got Midway here, and now an Junction Point. But we are an online town, and it's largely because of all the talent Richard brought to create this game, Ultima Online. Grand Theft Auto. Okay, everybody doesn't know. Maybe that's my ego talking. I've gotten in so much trouble talking about this game, I'm reluctant to do it again. So I'll just get it out of the way. I absolutely adore the game design. I love the gameplay in Grand Theft Auto, and I hate the content, okay? Its content is it's unspeakably horrible to me. Personal opinion only, your mileage may vary. But, you know, this is the game that is one of the high watermarks from a design standpoint that we cannot show off to people who could really make a difference, and that really annoys me. And I mean, I live for the day the guys at Rockstar apply their incredible talent to doing something that I can show my mother, okay? That out of the way. It certainly belongs on this list. Does anyone remember Grand Theft Auto 1, the first one? Holy cow, I'm stunned. Okay, I'm surprised. I didn't expect anybody to remember it. It was this silly little top-down thing where the gameplay was basically GTA 3, you know? And GTA 2 was basically GTA 3 from top-down 2D perspective, you know? Moving it into 3D has changed everything. It was amazing when that happened. You know, they honed their gameplay in those 2D games, perfected that side of it, and then, boom, put that amazing gameplay into a believable real-world setting. That was huge. There hadn't been any real-world settings at all when this game came out. Certainly not many that were remotely believable. I mean, this wasn't goofy science fiction or fantasy. This was, you know, right outside from a lot of people. Ripped from the headlines kind of stuff. Adults could play without feeling like stupid. That open-world gameplay with a pretty robust physics simulation, that's hugely powerful. Players creating their own gameplay happens every time somebody plays this game. I remember we were over at Ion Storm when this game came out, and one of my lead designers would sit for hours in our projection room, in our media room, playing, you know, life-size Grand Theft Auto 3. It was so amazing, and he would just drive me crazy. I would walk in there and watch him literally for hours, ignore the plot, ignore the story, and just like steal cars and set up the most amazing jumps he could find. He wanted to get the most air he could. That was all he cared about. And the game totally supported that. You know? If you were crazy, you could play this game not breaking the law and still have some fun, I guess. You know, you could do taxi missions. There was a little sex. You know, it was a... It looked really good. It had the best soundtrack around. This game had everything going for it, including... a sense of transgression. I mean, it's one of the things that games can do. We can allow players to test behaviors that we don't want them testing in the real world. GTA is like the ultimate example of that. Try stuff in this game, not in the real world, okay? Then we have all the honorable mentions. It's not a video game, I know. I'm sorry. But I'm completely convinced that without D&D, the video game industry would not exist. And frankly, we're only now outgrowing our geeky D&D roots. But I'll tell you right now that if you were there 20 years ago, 100% of the people in this business were trying to recreate their D&D campaigns. 100%. Anybody who says otherwise is lying. Okay. So every once in a while, you know, like face north towards Lake Geneva, Wisconsin, and bow down a little bit and say a little prayer thanks to Gary Gygax and Dan Barnes. Space War, that's the one that over there in the upper right. That 1962, MIT first video game, arguably. I guess there was a tic-tac-toe game before that, but you know that doesn't count. That's real-time action right there, in glorious black and white. Pong down there in the lower right, that was kind of brought video games, certainly to the bars, but even to the home. And interestingly, the Video Game Archive, the Center for American History's Video Game Archive, did a fundraiser recently. And Ralph Baer, who, could really argue, you could argue, he does argue, in fact, that he is the father of the video game. He's got a pretty good case. He actually created the first home Pong game that later morphed into the Magnavox Odyssey, sorry. He sent a prototype. It's like a wooden box that was like this big, attached to a black and white screen. It's got the most amazingly complex controller. I think he needed three hands to use it. And Richard Garriott and I sat down and played it. And it's as much fun as any game you can buy today. I was stunned. We were both stunned. A lot of the rudiments of game design are right there, have not changed. Terrifyingly, actually. John Madden Football is on the list here. First one came out in 1990, I think it was. Put EA on the map. Content that was acceptable to a mainstream audience. Perennially popular. Convinced publishers that the right thing to do was to create a new game and a franchise every year, which is crazy. It's a perennial. You gotta love it. Railroad Tycoon and Civilization are there because I had to have some Meyer games on there. I had to. And Halo, for the simple reason that it was the first console game, the first console first-person shooter, okay, that was any good. Okay, let's just cut to the chase. For years and years and years, everybody thought that the controller was not up to first-person shooter action. That there would never be a good first-person shooter on a console. And the guys who made Halo, the Bungie guys, just proved everybody wrong. They did it by tuning the control mechanism. The turn rate on Halo is perfect. There's no reason for anybody to think about that problem anymore. Do not quote me on this, but I think it's like 2.3 seconds to turn completely around. And if you take 2.4, it doesn't feel right. If you take 2.2, it doesn't feel right. Those guys nailed it, okay? They nailed the turn rate. They nailed everything. The AI is more sophisticated than it has any right to be. Really, really nicely executed version of an old school game on an entirely new platform, justifiably successful. And World of Warcraft, 9 million players. Holy cow. My wife is probably playing right now with her friend Panoy in San Jose. And her, who's like I think 19, and her 40-something female friend in Poland, I think it is. It's crazy. Any game that does that is of some significance. Okay. So there are other criteria we could apply. Would an overall sales should sales be taken into account? Should we talk about bestsellers? You can read the slide as well as I can. So overall sales, I'm doing this not so much because I think this is a real good list. And by the way, I'll warn you, every number you hear, any number you hear from anybody in the game business is a lie. So don't believe any of this, okay? But you can take it as sort of relative and as an indicator of how games have sold. In terms of overall sales, these are the best-selling games of all time, according to some sources. All right. So, are these the what is that? 11 best games of all time? Maybe you could argue. Well, it's because there are ties, right? you know, are these the best games of all time? I don't know. Maybe that's a pretty decent list. You know, Grand Theft Auto, and I mean, certainly I've burned a lot of hours on Gran Turismo 3. Holy cow, I sure did. Super Mario 64, another Grand Theft Auto game, you know, a couple of Pokemon games. My lead artist has now collected all 500 Pokemon in the latest version. He's very proud of that. Yeah, he comes at this weekend. He was out sick much of last week. Yeah, okay. So anyway, are these the 10 best, 11, whatever, however many best games? Again, you could argue that's a pretty decent list, you know? And certainly, in a course like this, if we maybe had a little bit more time together, it'd be interesting to see if there are any things that unite those games. What are the characteristics of those games that unite them, other than the fact that most of them are from Nintendo, on Nintendo platforms? I'm biased, I just love Nintendo. Okay, best sell by platform, is that an interesting metric to apply? Certainly, if you're a business person, that's an interesting little list. You know, or if you're a developer looking to you know, to find a platform to get behind, I with no malice towards Sony whatsoever, I don't know that I'd be going after the PSP right now. You know, PlayStation 3, I don't know. You know, but are those the best games of all time? Yeah, they're all pretty good. Again, it'd be interesting to go through this and see if there's anything that unites these. This frankly seems a little bit less useful to me, just because, you know, who cares about the Atari 2600 games? You know, bestsellers by franchise, is that something we should be thinking about? It certainly speaks to someone asked earlier about the percentage of things from Disney Interactive that are going to be supporting Disney brands. Look at this list. Says that supporting your brands is not the worst business model in the world. Okay. And a look at that list says, if you can't be creative working in the world of Zelda, or the world of Mario, or the world of Final Fantasy, maybe you should find another line of work. You know, franchises are huge, 193 million, oh my god. I mean, just the impact of reaching that many people, holy cow, I'd kill to do that. So anyway, franchises, that's another interesting metric to apply. Genre. If you're looking for, you know, putting a development studio together and you're trying to find a place to live, you know, you either better have a way of really goosing up the survival horror game market, or you might want to go where the money is. I've certainly been approached by a bunch of publishers asking me to do a Grand Theft Auto clone. And when I say, don't you think you should be developing something new, something different, rather than being, you know, 10th into a crowded market, their response is, if we pick up 10% of the Grand Theft Auto market, we're doing better than most original games do. Why wouldn't we go after that? You know? So, bestsellers by genre, it can help you find the right game to be making. So maybe that's a good thing to do. Metacritic scores. I almost made this list, darn it. anyway, yeah, I mean, Metacritic scores are huge nowadays. Most developers in their deals with publishers have incentives, have bumps to their royalty rates or bonus payments based on Metacritic scores. Does everybody know about Metacritic.com? Okay. I'm trying to think if I should make you take notes right now. We'll figure out a way to get this information to you. You need to live on Metacritic.com. You need to live on Blues News. You probably want to live on Penny Arcade. Anyway, Metacritic is a site that aggregates reviews and review scores for film, television, music, and video games, for media. And it is a widely used metric for determining how successful a game was. So these are the games that, if you take hundreds of reviews from hundreds of sources, magazines, online, newspapers, you name it, it's all in play. These are the best games of all time. And I got to tell you, I look at this, and this is a pretty damn good list. You know, I'm not crazy about some of these things, but I'm a Tony Hawk junkie. I can get behind that. No, I really am. I love Tony Hawk. and you know, Halo and Metroid Prime. I mean, those are some really good games there. And of course, it has a Zelda at the top, so I like the list. Ocarina of Time almost made my list. I had to cut some of my honorable mentions out to get through this. Although I'm actually ripping through this really fast. That's pretty cool. So here's the kind of ego portion of the evening. And this part of this talk is here largely because, like I said, I've been blogging about, you know, favorites lists and best lists recently because I'm kind of fascinated by this. People keep asking me, what about my own game? I figured I'd just sort of anticipate the question and talk about this. In terms of sort of favorites, I think I'd have to say Deus Ex, System Shock, and Underworld. I mean, they're games I still go back and play those games. I really just like them, you know. But that's like the favorite part of the list. These six games, I think, have enough significance that, you know, if I were really a raving egomaniac instead of just a fake egomaniac, I would probably put these games on some list somewhere, out of the ones I've worked on. So this one, Space Road, why is that one there? It was the first game I got to work on at Origin, and the guy up in the upper right, Paul Nurath, he's actually going to come visit us later in the semester. He was the director of the game and really gave me an education, so I hope he can help me make sure you guys get an education instead of listening to me drone on. This game is largely forgotten today, but it was hugely influential, at least on me. Anyway, because of the way it mixes the match genres. Those three screens are all from this one game. By the way, I have to tell you, this piece of box art, the one thing Paul and I told the guys in the marketing department was, please don't make him look like a motorcycle guy. Please. And so what do? They give us motorcycle guy. Ken Bacon in a motorcycle. Sometimes I'll say about Knights of Legend, too. That was a pretty funny story. We asked for, like, the Mighty Four, and they gave us bald pot-bellied guy. It was crazy. I still have those pictures somewhere. I'll forget those. Anyway, okay, so Paul, he came up with this crazy game that just mixed and matched genres. I mean, that it was a space combat simulator, sort of like Star Raiders, and definitely like Wing Commander became later. It was a role-playing game. I mean, sorry about this camera, guys. This is a text window where conversations would happen, and you would go talk to guys, and you'd buy stuff in that screen up there. So it had role-playing elements, and this thing down here was a video arcade. Like up there in that screen, there's a video game, and you could go up to it and play it. And I got to tell you, I mean, I probably shouldn't say this, and because I'm sure Paul will hear about this, but this was more fun than like anything else in the game. It's a silly little arcade game. And you could pump fake money into it, just play all day. It was great. You just killed ants and ant mounds and stuff. I mean, they were like mutant alien ants, so they were dangerous. Anyway, he mixed and matched genres really effectively, in much the same way that you know, later on, I mean, I got to do in Deus Ex and other games. But even beyond the influence of this game was successful enough at the time that it allowed Paul to set up Blue Sky Productions, which did Ultima Underworld, and later became Looking Glass Technologies, which created Thief and many other really incredible games, and frankly seeded the industry with an entire generation, like a generation one removed from Paul, of developers who are still changing things today, including Doug Church, who's working with Steven Spielberg at EA now, and Ken Levine, who's over at Irrational, working on Bioshock, Rob Fermier, who's working at an Ensemble on some stuff that I can't talk about. And just many, many, many more. I mean, that guy is an unsung hero in the game business. And Space Rogue was one of his you know, best games, I think. Ultima 6. This was also an education for me. So again, there's a personal aspect to it. Richard actually dressed like that. It was really terrifying. Wow. Anyway. Maybe we'll get him to come here in his Lord British suit. That'd be amazing. He still got it. I got to work with Rich on Ultima 6, and it was a pretty stunning experience. Imagine it's 1990, okay? Those were graphics that were way better than most games back then. The UI, I mean, just having clickable buttons as opposed to using every key on the keyboard. That was a little revelation at the time. The conversation system was streamlined, yet still as powerful as it had ever been. You could, get wheat and crush it to make flour and combine it with water to make dough and cook it to make bread, which you could then take out in the field with you. I mean, it was a really remarkable simulation in a way. It had the ethical underpinnings that every Ultima had had since Ultima 4. The most important thing about Ultima 6, though, for me anyway, and maybe for others, is that it really showed me the power of emergent gameplay. The power of the idea that allowing players to solve problems the way they want to had to be the future of gaming. And again, lots of people disagree with me, but that's been kind of the core of my philosophy, I guess, ever since. I don't want to take the time right now, but anyway, this was a really important game in that it changed the way I think about games. It was also Origin's first big PC title game. I think it was literally the first PC game we did, and we totally learned a ton, mostly by screwing up. Again, Richard was the trailblazer. It was a magical game. Ultima Underworld makes the list. It was largely a tech experiment. Again, you have to remember, as primitive as that looks, I wish I had a screenshot of Castle Wolfenstein 3D, because this game came out before Wolfenstein did. And frankly, I think, no knock on Wolfenstein, it was more sophisticated in what it was visually, in what it was trying to do. You could actually look up and down in this game. Ooh. It was a pretty serious role-playing game. It was pretty neat. That the guy up there, that's the church, who, again, I'm hoping to get in here, he's now working with Steven Spielberg. He started out working with Paul Neurath, and we've collaborated on a bunch of projects. So again, this was in my mind the first game that really deserves we used to call the games we made immersive simulations, where we really wanted to feel like you were there. It wasn't just that you were maneuvering an avatar through a world and maneuvering a puppet. It was really you in this world. And this is the first game that really kind of clicked on that level. If you haven't played it, it's take this with a grain of salt, because I worked on this game, right? But it's still the state of the art in role playing, which is pathetic. Okay, if you upgraded the graphics in this game, this would be role playing RPG state of the art. It was crazy, and it's 15 years later. And level 4 of this game is absolutely magical. Okay. The level 4 of the Stygian Abyss is amazing. It showed that you really could combine character development, player choice, action, shooting, bows and stuff, storytelling, everything in one package. This was the first game that proved that to me. System Shock, in a sense, it was a small step forward from Underworld. But there were just enough new elements that I think it's worth putting on the list. It did establish some new storytelling conventions. I mean, there's like Bioshock now has all those video or those logs that you can collect, the emails you can collect. System Shock was the first game that did that. That was an innovation that was conceived at Trees, right up the street, over Megas. It was the first game that allowed you to lean, but that little thing up. You see this right here? This is so funny. We were convinced that no one would be able to figure out that they were leaning, based on the fact that they were leaning. So we put a little like figure of a guy in there. It's, what were we thinking? The UI was a mess on this game, by the way. The lean, that was conceived at the Texas Chili Parlor. So if you ever want to know where gaming history was made, Trudy's and the Texas Chili Parlor. This game put more of an emphasis on simulation than any game that I know of before this, or certainly than I had worked on. We supported VR headsets, so we had head tracking, and you could, you put on Forte VFX 1, not that any of you remember that, or the CyberMax, which we used to call the Cyber Brick, because it weighed about 10 pounds and was all focused right on your nose. Not a problem for me, a problem for some other people with littler noses. But anyway, this was simulation, immersion, player choice, emergent gameplay. We also, I think in this game, we kind of put characterization more in players' hands than we ever had before. In this game, you weren't playing Lara Croft. You weren't playing even the Avatar, all of whom had, characters who had distinct personalities. Mario has a distinct personality. In this game, we wanted no impediment to believe that it was you in the world. So in this game, you were just the hacker. You never spoke. You had no personality, except the personality that you as a player brought to the game. And that's a critical design decision, a discussion that you have to have every time you start a game. We'll come back to that in a minute. Okay. Thief. First, just to be clear, my role, I get way too much credit for this game, and I want to make sure everybody understands. I was a part of Thief's creation like in the middle year of a three-year cycle, okay? So, I'm proud of what I contributed to this thing, but fundamentally, I get way too much credit. So that out of the way. This was the first stealth simulation. We called it a first-person sneaker. And what it did was it took the conventions of the first-person shooter and kind of stood them on the ear. Looked like an FPS, in a fantasy setting, of course. But if you played it like an FPS, you were doomed, okay? It was not a game of slam-bang action. It was a game about being balanced on the razor's edge of dimension, right? This is a game that succeeded not when you were in combat and not when you were completely safe, but when you knew guys were looking for you and when you knew that any misstep on your part could result in disaster. It was that split second before something terrible happened that was the engine that drove Thief, okay? And no game had done that before. Now we have stealth simulations all over the place and sneaking games all over the place. Some of them, have outstripped Thief in a lot of ways, but Thief was the first. Metal Gear Solid, I already hear the questions. Metal Gear Solid is an excellent arcade game that has some sneaking around, okay? It's an excellent game, but this is a stealth simulation in a way that frankly, very few games have even tried to be. And it was the first. Deus Ex, this was the game that was all about shared audio. I mean, frankly, it was created out of frustration with Thief because as much as I love the Thief games, Thief was also a game where the player was consciously weakened. I mean, think about that. The games are almost always about power fantasies, about fulfilling power fantasies, letting players do things they couldn't do in any other way. And Thief was all about weakening the player to force a gameplay style. If you gave the character too much sword power, there'd be no reason to sneak. You just go around and kill everything that moves, because that's the easy way out. There's always find the easy way. Always. Like a vital thing to remember as a designer. But I was convinced that you could make a game that supported stealth and supported a more traditional shooter gameplay style and supported role-playing games. I mean, basically, this was the game that you could fight, sneak, or talk your way past any problem. That was one of our starting points. We had a bunch of little, one-liners to define the game, but that was the one that really got it started. It was also the real-world role-playing game. That was another one of our one-liners. So, like Grand Theft Auto, we were trying to make a game that felt like it was set in the real world. And I actually made the team build locations based on blueprints. I got blueprints of the Statue of Liberty and of many other locations, including the White House, which was kind of interesting. I'll tell you that story later. It was a game that was about something. I mean, I really think that, and we're going to talk about story at some point during the semester, and I think game stories have to be about more than their surface, just the way a film story has, it is about more than its surface, and a novel's story is about more than its surface. Deus Ex, I don't even care if nobody else in the world realizes it, but Deus Ex is about family. What does it mean to be a family? How do we define a family? Okay, there are family relationships all through the game. It's about what does it mean to be human, and at what point do you stop being human, and what things will you sacrifice for your humanity? It's about the balance of personal freedom and the good of a community. What's best for a community versus what the value of personal freedom. And I have my own opinions about that stuff. But the whole point of Deus Ex, just as we didn't want to force a play style, I didn't want to force my politics or my ideology on players, okay? And so what we did was we engaged in a dialogue with players. We let players decide how they felt about that stuff. And at the end of the game, it wasn't that they killed a monster and saved the world, it's they decided how the world should look. Not based on what the characters said or did, not based on what I wanted them to do, but what they personally, as human beings, not as players, and not as characters, what they thought was the right thing to do. And as cool as it was that the players solved problems the way they wanted, one of the coolest things to me was getting on the forums after this game shipped and realizing that we had succeeded in that. That players actually were talking about, how could you have thought the world would be better off, you know, with a sentient AI uniting all of us there, and there's no personal, you know, nothing personal anymore. Everything is communal. How could you think that was the way the world should be? People argued about that. And I actually gave a talk at the New School in New York, and went out to a bar, sorry mom, afterwards with a bunch of people from the audience. And I had, at one point in the evening, I swear this is true. It sounds like an apocryphal story, but it's really true. I had a drunk fan sitting on this side of me, like, giving me a hard time. How could you make that right-wing piece of junk, Deus Ex? And another drunk guy walked up and said, what are you talking about? It was a left-wing radical piece of junk. And I was able to leave those two guys arguing about whether the politics of Deus Ex were left-leaning or right-leaning. And I just said, my work here is done. I mean, I got two drunks arguing with each other about politics. Drunk gamers, holy cow. It's certainly the best reviewed game I've ever worked on, and the best selling game I've ever worked on, and from a creative standpoint, it pretty much accomplished all the goals I set out for it. Pretty successful. Okay, we have 40 minutes. I actually have one more thing I'm going to do. I got about 20 minutes of more gabbing to do, but I think we should take a break. If you guys have any questions, I'm happy to answer them while we're breaking, whatever. But I think we should take 10 minutes and then come back. Everybody okay? Anybody got any questions? I've reduced you to silence. I win. Wake up. Come on. So my original plan was to get some folks out here to talk about game analysis and criticism this week. To help you guys with your assignment for next week, so you'd have some idea of what, you know, about the readings, what to actually think about and talk about. So it's not like I have time to do any close analysis of much of anything, but I wanted to run through some of the things that you need to be thinking about when you do your critiques for next week. You need to be thinking about this if you're going to actually develop a game. You need to be thinking about this if you're going to be a game critic, and God knows we need them. So I'm hoping this will be useful to you and provide at least a little bit of a foundation or starting point for you. So one of the things we can do is we can think about content. What's the developer trying to tell me? Okay, is there a difference between the surface story and the themes being expressed in the game? Okay. Kind of what I was saying before about Deus Ex being about way more than just do you shoot something or do you sneak past it. You can think about how the story is communicated. Is it communicated through cutscenes? I mean, like I talked earlier about Japanese RPGs, which are very much completely linear cutscene, you know, gameplay, cutscene, gameplay, cutscene, gameplay. People cry, you know, in Final Fantasy games. But they cry because the Final Fantasy story is being told as a movie, right? That's a solved problem. It's not hard to make people feel something when all they're doing is watching a movie, okay? How is the story communicated? How does the player interact with the story? Are players just being told the story? Are they somehow driving the story through their actions? Do they uncover it? Is the story, what passes for story in games is often just backstory? The gradual revelation of backstory. I think Bioshock is the perfect example of that right now. Most of what you're doing is not telling a new story, but uncovering the secrets of this place as you play. And absolutely nothing wrong with that. What kind of story is being told? Okay, so that's one thing you can think about. Mission structure. Well, is the game mission-based? I mean, that's the first thing. How are missions structured? I meant to put another slide in here. I realized I didn't put it in here. Is it a branching tree? I mean, as you play the game, think about this. Are there failure paths? Are there success paths? Is it completely linear and then, you know, the string of pearls where everybody does mission one before everybody does mission two before everybody does mission three? Is it freeform? Is GTA freeform? I could answer that. Maybe we'll talk about that at some point. How are the missions structured, if the game is even mission structured at all? And how does the player actually get those missions? Okay. Rewards schedules. Critical, critical, critical. If you're a designer, this is about half of your job. You may not even realize it, by the way. Maybe you shouldn't think of it consciously. But this is about half the job of the designer. How frequently are you rewarding the player? What kinds of things are you giving? Are you giving them points? Are you giving them stars? Are you giving them new tools? Are you giving them little bits of story? Are you opening up a new location? What are the rewards that you're giving? And how often are they given? What behaviors are you rewarding? Okay, that's a critical thing. Every design decision you make as a developer and every kind of interaction you engage in as a player is telling you, you should do more of this, or you should do less of this, player. How is the game doing that? What is it telling you to do more of and less of, and how is it telling you? Okay, and how are those rewards delivered? Those are all things you can think about as you play a game. And you need to start playing games in a slightly different way. This is not just about playing games. This is about understanding them, right? That's what you're here to do. You could write a treatise on the save load scheme of a game. You would not believe the arguments. God, it's insane. The argument that people have in the game development community about saving and loading. Should you be able to save anywhere? Should you not be allowed to save at all? Is the game you never save the grail of game design? What are you doing? What is the game doing to prevent constant saving, which really can get to be a drag, you know? Typically, when you save and load a game, you give something up. In Thief, for example, or Super Mario, for that matter, you give up territory. In Bioshock, you give up a little bit of territory. What is the game asking you to give up when you load a save game? Okay. And what impact does it have on the overall experience, on the pacing of play? All sorts of things you can think about with save load schemes. I really am ripping through this. I apologize for this. These are, any one of these could be like a whole semester. It's crazy. Controls. There's almost nothing more important than the sort of kinesthetics of the experience, right? I mean, it's you, the controller, or a keyboard, a mouse in your hands. What are the specifics of the control scheme? Is every button, we were talking about this earlier. I mean, is it good to have to use every button on a controller just because you can? Is a game that uses every key on the keyboard, is that a deep, sophisticated game for serious gamers, as opposed to one that has one button to use? I mean, Peter Mullen, who's working on Fable 2 right now, and I got to talk to him about that at E3, and literally, Fable 2 is one button. And it's crazy cool, trust me, okay? So what is your control scheme? How does the player interface with the world? We talk about turrets, how to turn rates, jump heights, jump distances, run speeds, how do they contribute or detract from the experience? Okay, and what impact, if you want to think about it really as a developer, your run speed and jump height and all that stuff, it's going to determine so much about your game. I mean, how big is your level? How vertical can your level be? What size do the objects have? I mean, it's amazing how important that kind of really detail-y stuff can be. How do the camera controls work? That's another one. There are so many different ways of dealing with the camera in a game. You're constantly thinking about that. And every game is different. If you want to look at a game that does it pretty damn well, Mario 64's camera controls are spot on. I mean, they're really great. But Mario's controls might not work for example, the game I'm working on now that I can't tell you about. Look at the game and how does the camera work? Where does it work? Where does it break? You know, if it's a camera control system that's useful in an outdoor area, what happens when you move indoors? You have walls close in all the time. Think about all that stuff, all right? And see what you can come up with. character development. I mean, obviously, is there any, you know, how does it work? You know, I talked about System Shock earlier, and how you were just a hacker. In ASX, you had a name, but we, I mean, I don't know if those of you who played it, I mean, I remember the guy who did the voice talent, he really wanted one at the end. I mean, he was a really good actor, and we made him talk like this the whole time, and we didn't let him show any emotion at all, because we had no idea what emotion the player was going to be feeling at any moment in time, because, you know, you might be sneaking, sorry, I can't do this anymore. Anyway, you might be sneaking around and feeling really, you know, good and cool and powerful, or you might be shooting like crazy, be scared, angry, and, you know, you might walk into a room and talk to someone and hate them and they hate you, or in the same game, same situation, that guy might be your best friend. If we had a character with a name, and, sorry, with a personality and a voice, and that voice and personality was not expressing what the player was feeling, we were doomed, you know? So does the player character have a name and a voice and a personality? How does that reflect the developer's intentions for the game? And all of this stuff ties back into reward schedule, story communication modes, the overall gameplay experience. So think about how all of this ties together. Feedback. There are two kinds of feedback. I can't believe I'm doing this in 3 minutes, man. This really is a lecture. Holy cow. Positive. There are two ways to think. Feedback means two things in games. It means two things on the screen. There are positive and negative feedback loops. A positive feedback loop is something where if we're encouraging a particular kind of behavior. So a guy gets in a racing game, guy gets ahead, and the game basically doesn't do anything doesn't provide a negative feedback loop to draw him back, okay, or provide anything that allows players behind to catch up. Positive feedback loop just says if you do this and you do it well, you'll get even better at it, okay. And sometimes you want that. Sometimes you want a guy in the lead to sort of to take off and get even further in the lead to bring a game to an end. Sometimes, though, you want to encourage competition, so you need to introduce a negative feedback loop, something that pulls a really effective player back to increase competition, to make less effective players more challenging. Okay? So look at this game and see, what are they doing that's introducing positive or negative feedback loops? And the other meaning of feedback is simply player communication. I mean, feedback in a game is everything. We are the only medium that lets players actually do stuff, okay, instead of just watch stuff and interpret. The player needs to know what he or she can do, and needs to know what impact what he or she is about to do is likely to have, and needs to know what impact it did have after he or she acts, okay? That's all player feedback. So how is the game communicating to the player, hey player, you can do X, Y, and Z, okay? Hey player, if you do X, Y, and Z, you're likely to get result A, B, and C. I'm not really sure, but you're probably going to get A, B, and C. And once you've done it, how does the player know what the impact of what happened? How does the player know what happened? Okay. This is like the most important thing. If you take nothing away from this semester, please just take this away, okay? Games are about verbs. They're not about nouns or adjectives. I mean, Will Wright kind of disagrees with this, so he's probably right, and I'm probably wrong. But we'll talk more about this before the semester's over. Games are all about what players can do, all right? And so, think about what the verbs of the game are. Run, jump, shoot, right? Explore. I mean, just identify the verbs of any game, and you're halfway to understanding it. Right? And then look for good and bad verbs. Like, does the verb, the player learns about it. If you're a designer, and you say, the player learns X, Y, and Z, does that tell you anything useful? How does the player learn? What does the player do to learn? If you say, the player runs, that's very clear. It's very straightforward. It's very useful. It's a useful verb for a designer. Learn, not a useful verb. So look at the games you're playing or the game you're critiquing and identify the verbs, both good and bad, okay? And then finally, these are seven questions. Before I even take a game to the one-page concept write-up, I ask myself these questions. And I thought about not going through this now, but hold off until we talk about, you know, sort of how you make a game. But I thought it might be useful actually as an analytical tool. If it ends up not being useful, I apologize. But from a critical perspective, I think these might be useful. So think about, what is the game trying to do? What does Halo want you to feel or experience or be as you play? What's the core idea behind the game? What's the potential of that idea? What is it about that core idea that led the developer to make that game and not the infinite other games that could have been made? Okay. What are the most challenging things the developer tackled? When you look at the thing, I mean, you might not even realize, like I was talking earlier in the break, people don't even appreciate how sophisticated the AI is in Deus Ex 2. They got so hung up on other things that didn't work quite as well as they might have. I don't think they even appreciate how sophisticated the AI is. That was a huge, huge challenge. A lot of the criticism of the levels in Deus Ex 2 were a result of technical limitations that resulted in levels that were too small to contain the gameplay, the game style that we wanted to offer players. And that was because of a dynamic lighting model. Anyway, the point is, we tackled some development challenges that had huge design ramifications. Right? So what are the big challenges that developers were tackling? Has anyone done a game like this before? If you ask that question and the answer is no, then you're automatically on a path towards understanding something about the game. What is it that makes this game unique? Okay? And when you start answering that question, you're on your way to a decent analysis. How well suited to games? The idea. I've actually started talking about this more because I find it kind of interesting. I used to not talk about this. I didn't tell my teams. I didn't tell my wife I did this. It's something I did. And But I talked about this publicly for the first time when I was on a love story panel with Will Wright, and and Raph Koster, who's a really swell designer, and we had to come up with a love story, and it's like basically I fumbled the ball because man, we are not well suited to tell love stories. Holy cow! And it'd be interesting to discuss why that is sometime. But anyway, how well suited is the idea to games? What's the player fantasy? What does that lead to? Good player goals and good player verbs. And again, what does the player do? What are the verbs? Okay, that's the key thing. That 10 minutes. Awesome. Okay, I'm done. Anybody got any questions? Okay, so apply those things to your. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Can you talk more about the feedback loop?
Oh God. how about if we hold that off for another time? That really is a lecture. I'm happy to give it. But frankly, I'm hoping we get a guy named Mark LeBlanc in here who is pure genius at explaining things. So what I'll probably do is have him come in and run you through that. Okay? It's really important. So I want to make sure we do it justice. Okay. Oh.
I just want to say it's 10 till 8. So any questions maybe they